Hi to all. Visual Concept Detection and Linked Open Data at the TIB AV Portal. So today we want to talk about machine learning and visual concept detection, and especially how to express the results of these processes as linked open data. And the use case will be the TIB AV Portal. The background of our presentation is that we just integrated a new and improved module for visual concept detection into the portal itself, and that this module was researched and developed at TIB by the Competence Center for Non-Textual Materials and by the Research Group on Visual Analytics. So let's take a look at the agenda. We will start out with a short introductory part on the TIB itself and the TIB AV portal, followed by some background information on the automated video analysis we are already employing at the TIB portal. And this is followed by a part on visual concept detection and data quality, which will be presented by my colleague Matthias Springstein. And then I will wrap it up with some explanations about the data model we use and the ways of data publication and reuse scenarios of our metadata. So let's start with TIB, the Technische Informationsbibliothek, or in English, the German National Library of Science and Technology. We are not only the German National Library of Science and Technology, but the University Library at Hannover as well. And in that, we are the world's largest science and technology library at the moment. And we see ourselves as an infrastructure provider for the whole scientific work progress. Central to our strategy is the idea to move beyond text. So what we want to do is fundamentally improve access and use of non-textual materials, just like with textual materials we are used to. And core to this is the Competence Center for Non-Textual Materials, which was founded in 2011, I think, and the Visual Analytics Research Group Matthias is working for. The TIB AV portal, for those who don't know it already, is a platform for quality-tested scientific videos. It's online since 2014. We did a relaunch. 2016 did some GUI tweaking. New corporate design was integrated. And it was developed by TIB and Hasso-Plattner-Institut in Potsdam. Its main features are that we do automatic metadata enrichment and extraction. We use digital object identifiers and media fragment identifiers for stable and permanent referencing of scientific videos. We offer long-term preservation, and we have several features like semantic search, cross-lingual search, and so on. Some key figures. At the moment, there are about 11,500 videos online at the TIB portal. We roughly have 1,000 visitors a day. And there are several types of videos, scientific videos in the portal at the moment, from conference recordings, like, for example, this conference could be part of the AV portal. We've got lectures. There are videos of experiments from chemistry or physics. We got video supplements like video abstracts, simulations, and so on. All these videos, or most of these videos, are published under open access licenses, Creative Commons, for example, so they could be downloaded and reused freely by the scientific community. So let's take a look at the metadata extraction process we are already using at the AV portal. Basically, this is what I personally think sets the AV portal apart at the moment. We've got this nice process chain of 5 steps for each video that is uploaded into the portal. And the goal is to extract descriptive metadata for each video automatically. So on the first step, we do a short boundary detection, which is a scene recognition, basically, where we, oh, that's too far, where we segment the videos into different scenes and extract keyframes for each of the scenes. Which we will be using later for preview, for example. I will show you this. Then in the second step, we do an automated speech recognition, which is basically a speech-to-text transformation, where we extract audio transcripts from the videos, followed by text recognition or video OCR, where we try to extract text displayed within the video. For example, subtitles, overlays. If you see this video of my presentation at the moment, maybe later on you will see the slides in the background, and then the OCR goes over the slides and it extracts text from there as well. This is followed by the an image recognition, the visual concept detection itself. We already do this. We had an older module which was replaced which tries to extract visual features from the videos. For example, it can recognize that this is a conference presentation, if it's a lecture, or things you see within the video, like machinery, experiments, a rocket, for example. On top of that, we do a named entity linking. This is based on the OCR and the speech transcript, where we link entities against the German integrated authority file. So we use a common knowledge base for that. To illustrate this a bit, let's look at the results of this process. First of all, like I said, we segment the videos, so you get different segments of video which you could use to navigate through the videos itself. And for each video, there are several keyframes that are used for preview functions. Or this, the segments are aligned with the audio transcript, which is also segmented. So for each segment, you get a part of the audio transcript. We do this in English and German at the moment. And on top of that, as I already said, you've got the named entities from the GND, the integrated authority file. So in this example, software is mentioned within the transcript, and it's linked to the GND entity. And the visual concept detection results are basically based on the video keyframes we extracted. So again, these are aligned with the video segments. And as a result, you've got an annotation for each of these segments. So let's look at the example here. You can see a molecular structure shown, and this is linked to the visual concept of molecular geometry in this case. And how all this works and the underlying technology will be presented to you by Matthias. Thanks.
Hello, everyone. So I will talk a little bit about the technical specification or the technique behind this module. And first, I will start with a short introduction to the topic of supervised learning of an image classifier. And this the whole pipeline contains of two modules. The first is the feature extraction, and the second one is the classifier module. The task for the feature extraction is to generate a good representation of the input data and also do a feature reduction, dimensional reduction for the input data. And the task for the classifier module is to take this data and then assign a label based on this feature extraction. So for example, when the image shows us a stone or something else, then the classifier at the end will label this image contains a stone or shows a stone. So the supervised learning process is split in two parts. One is the training process, and the second one is the prediction. In the training process, we feed input data through our pipeline, and at the end, we generate labels from the model. And we also need ground truth labels for the input data. So for example, we have an image from a stone, and then we need this image truly contains a stone. So and what we are doing is we optimize. So we change the parameter of the models that the models more likelihood predict that it shows a stone. So as a short introduction to this topic. So we repeat this step several times, and when we are done with the training, then we use the trained model and put it in our prediction module. Then we use new data that without new labels and use the predicted label from our model. So now we'll talk a little bit about our previous solution. The previous solution use scalar image feature transformation and back of visual worlds for the feature extraction and support vector machines for the classification module. The SIFT feature are computed at a certain point inside the image and based on the orientation and magnitude of gradients inside the image. And we compute these features across a grid over the whole image. So we separate this, so we compute several hundred points per image of the SIFT features. But this the features only describe the local part of this image. It's only based on the local area around this point. So, and for the image classification, we need a global or an image-wide representation, feature representation for the whole image. And for that case, we use back of visual words. Then we use all SIFT features that we extract from the whole training data set and cluster that to a certain cluster reads. Center, so maybe 1,000 clustered centrons, and then when we see a new image during the training process, we compute the SIFT features, and then we only generate a histogram over this feature, so we count the number of SIFT features that looks similar to this one. So, and at the end, we generate only one histogram per image, and we use a support vector machine to classify one concept each all other. So we only use images that show stones and compare it with all other images that do not show stones. Yeah, this whole system is trained with more than 8,000 manually annotated images, and the system could distinguish between 49 concepts, but only 16 of them was deployed. Okay, now to our new approach, and I will only give you a short overview of these techniques. We're utilizing a deep learning approach. We call it convolutional neural networks. And the main improvement to the previous step is that we train the feature extractor and the classifier model together. So we don't use handcrafted features as the previous slide show. Now we use we train the feature extractor. So the features that we extract are based on the data, and not from the human that designed these features. So this this neural network contains several layers. Current approach have more than some of them have more than 1,000 of these layers. I only show you 4 of these layers. And the first stages of this networks contains the convolutional layer, the name. Yeah. So the network is called about this layer. And you should think about it's a sliding window that moves over the image. So this is a sliding window. This is moved from left to the right and from top to bottom. And we only compute for this input size, we compute only one of these features. And here you can see how this feature will look like. So in the first step, we only extract edges. And when you go deeper inside the network, then the features base it on the previous layer. So in the first step, you compute, you find edges. In the next step, you find textures. And when you go further and further, at the end, you can detect car wheels in these examples. So this is for the classical, the convolutional layer. And at the end, we use a fully connected neural network that predicts us the probability that a certain concept is visible inside the frame. Okay, now to some other points. For this kind of network, we need more training data than the original system. This network tries to overfit a little bit when we only use 10 or 1,000 images. So we create a new data set that contains 50,000 images. This set is created semi-supervised compared to the other one that is manually annotated. Here we only utilize Google Image Search to find training examples for a specific concept. We apply the Inception ResNet V2 network structure from Google from last year. There's also more than 100 of these layers that you can see in the previous slide. And to prevent the overfitting, we pre-train this model on a good annotated data set with more than 1 million images and 1,000 concepts. And the final system could distinguish between 73 visual concepts and is trained for 40 epochs. So the network looks 40 times the whole data set. Okay, this is for the training and our model, and then some points about the data quality. During the training, we rapidly evaluate our model. So after 1,000 iterations, we check is the model still learning, or maybe it's overfitting. So we generate another data set with 1,100 manually annotated images. And we rapidly compute the mean average position on this data set, and we take the module that has the highest score on the validation data set with 0.33 mean average position over all concepts. But the target of the module is not to predict the probability of this module. We only want to predict binary labels. So we have to find a threshold at which probability we say, okay, this video shows a conference or not. So to achieve this, we compute the F1 score to determine the thresholds for the binary labels. Then when we go to the testing, we deploy our module to our AV portal systems so that we could test the whole processing pipeline. So from finding the keyframes, loading the images, predict the probabilities of each concept, and then to visualize on the front ends. And for the future work, we want to adjust a little bit the threshold. So some of the concepts are seen too often currently. So we want to improve this, and also we want to filter the noisy images in the training datasets. So currently, for example, we search for tables, but in English you also could mention it's not only Excel, it's maybe this one. So it's a bit noisy, the dataset currently. Okay, then this was my part.
Okay, thanks. So because it's about semantic web and linked open data, we just take a quick look on our data model to wrap it up. So all metadata we have and we are extracting is expressed and stored as RDF. So we have a triple store on the backend. And in this example, you can see that we have the annotation with molecular geometry I already showed you. So I hope this is the laser pointer. As you can see, we have an annotation which was done by the visual concept detection. That's the visual concept. It was annotated. And here we've got the link to the GND entity of this annotation. The model we used to express this, we already saw, I think, on Tuesday, or was it yesterday? It's the open annotation data model. I think it was the example of Derrida, and he called someone a hypocrite, if I recall correctly. So we use the same data model for the annotating, the open annotation data model. And on top of that, several common vocabularies like bibframe, doubling core, friend of a friend, and so on. So all this makes for a nice graph as well. I can quickly walk you through it. So basically, we see an annotation here, which is linked to a part of the video, which we identify by time codes. And this part is part of the video, of course. And this annotation has a body, which is the visual concept we just detected. It's a semantic tag. And to link it to other knowledge bases, we related to the GND or Wikidata or DBpedia, for example. So we have mappings to each of these knowledge bases in the backend. The publication of our data comprises of everything, the authoritative metadata, which is curated manually, but also the extracted metadata. So for example, the metadata of the visual concept detection. And there are several ways we publish it at the moment. Of course, we provide RDF dumps by CC0 licenses, which we update, I think, every 3 months at least. So you can download all our metadata and do whatever you want with it. We made our URIs dereferenceable. We used LotView for that. There's a content negotiation mechanism where you can get the metadata for single entities, for example, or you can explore our metadata by this. And just recently, we set up a server of triple pattern fragments within our TIP labs, where the actual RDF dumps are provided as triple pattern fragments. And what we are planning to do probably in the next year is to set up a public Sparkle endpoint as well. So just a quick look at reuse. What's already happening is the metadata is integrated in different library catalogs. For example, the Saxon State and University Library just integrated our metadata. And it's part of the Deutsche Digitale Bibliothek, the German Digital Library. But this is only the authoritative metadata, not the extracted metadata at the moment. So, but we link it, and it's, I don't think we saw this image yet. It's part of the Linked Open Data Cloud, of course. You can link to it. You can use it in your own services. So you can, for example, link to certain parts of videos which are relevant to whatever you want to provide. So if there's anything you already do, let us know. We don't see everything that's happening. So if you want to use it and have questions, you can ask us, of course. So okay, that's from us. Now we're looking forward to your questions. Thank you for your attention.
Whoa, all right. Well, thank you for that. I guess the audio was really excited too about that work. Okay, nobody move. thank you for that. Okay, so we've got time for questions. Do folks have questions on this presentation? Still processing it. Yes, sir, in the back, wait for a mic, or here, I'll bring you mine. Because it doesn't make the fuzzy noise. Great, can you pass it over, please? Thank you.
Hi there. For your data model, a lot of what we saw in that could be expressed or converted to a IIIF representation of the video with all its annotations using the W3C annotation model. I wondered if that's something that you'd considered or were aware of, because there's a huge overlap between what you're doing here and what the IIIF AV work is at the moment.
So I know there are things happening with IIIF. I think the model was created 2012, 13, something about that. And I think it's historically grown, of course. But right. we know that IIIF is happening. Maybe we could map it to another data model at some point. But
yeah, we should have a talk about that.
Yeah, cool. Could.
Thank you.
Other questions? Oh, up in the front. Is that one? Oh.
Thank you. Is this software that you use for the visual concept detection open source available?
We want to answer.
Yeah, we could make it open source, I think. So currently it's not open source, but the problem is that the previous model is developed by the Hasenbachler Institute with us, and we couldn't open source the whole portal, but we could open source the module.
Maybe to add to that, the module is very customized to fit into the portal at the moment. So the wrapper around it is very custom, and you couldn't just reuse it because it's so tightly integrated into the portal's architecture. But the technology we are using, TensorFlow and the trained network, could easily be open sourced, of course, then reused in your own environment. But what we are planning to do is to make the portal itself open source in the near future. So there's a project just starting to do it in the next 2-3 years to modularize it, and then you could, of course, reuse this module as well for your own infrastructure.
Sure, we can get this question.
Yes, thank you for your presentation. It is a semantic web edit on machine learning, I think. So I want to ask, how was the performance of the one is the speech recognition, and the other one is text SVM classifier of the performance? How well recognized or classified?
You asked about the speech recognition, and the second I didn't get.
The SVM, the automatic classifier.
So maybe I talk about the speech recognition, and then you could say something about the performance of the visual concept detection. So the speech recognition we do with an external partner. So we just give them our videos. They create the transcripts, extract the transcripts, and give them back to us. So we integrate them into our portal. I think this greatly depends on the quality of the source material. So if the if somebody has an accent, for example, or if the audio quality isn't good, then the audio transcripts suffer greatly, I think. Maybe you see it on YouTube, for example, the differences in the quality. So if you've got good sound quality and somebody who speaks very clearly, for example, then the results are quite good. But it's greatly differs concern, depending on the source material. But I can't give you exact numbers in percentages of recognition, for example. So it really, really depends on the individual video you are analyzing. Yeah. So to the...
Okay, we currently we compare our model only against our validation dataset, and we could achieve 0.33 mean average position. So this is a ranking loss. So you should think about you search for a specific topic, maybe stones or bridges or conference videos. Then we sort the results, and then the order. So when the results are in front of the list, then we get 1 for the mean average position. So you see, it's, there's a lot of space to, for improvement, and you should think about this score is over all concepts. For some of the concepts, it's very, the results are very good, maybe better than humans. For example, when you think about fish or something else, it's, mm-hmm. it's already inside the pre-trained model. And the, this kind of image classification could show that it's better than humans for this 1 million images, 1,000 classes. But then when we get more confused, so for example, we have we split the module in several domains, and for example, there's a domain for architecture, and then we have a concept that is building, then we have a concept that is city, but this concept are overlap. So currently this reduced the performance a little bit. So maybe we see a frame, and the frame is only annotated with buildings, but it could also be annotated with city. And so on. Mm. And for astronomy, for example, when, yeah.
Well, thank you for that. If you've got other questions, you can grab these guys later. Thank you very much.